Lorraine. It's so nice to see you. It's been quite a few weeks since we've actually seen each other in the flesh, hasn't it?
Yeah.
How have you been doing?
I think the last time we saw each other, we recorded the podcast in a car, didn't we? In a car park.
We did.
The beginning
Postcards from Midlife.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, no, I'm doing okay.
Good.
Yeah, no, I think...
Good. Good.
Well, swing.
Now, I think we first met, I think it was in the 90s, wasn't it? I remember you became editor of B Magazine. You were Lorraine Butler at the time, I think.
That's right.
It was before you were married. And you've had an amazing magazine career. And I think probably fair to say we had the kind of heyday of magazines, didn't we, as editors?
Yes, I think I feel like we got in at the right time, didn't we? So I started on newspapers, and then I worked at Marie Claire with Glenda Bailey after working at the Times. And then I edited B Magazine and then Cosmo, which I really enjoyed, Cosmopolitan. And then for 12 years, I was at Elle, which is a big, glossy fashion magazine. And now I'm editor-in-chief of Style Magazine. So you've just come out of Marie Claire, haven't you, Trish? Where did you start? I can't remember where you started.
Gosh, I've got such a long list. I kind of started at More Magazine, went to New Woman Magazine, but my first editorship was Red Magazine about 2 years after it launched in 1999. And I was editor there for 7 years. And that was an amazing time. We had this slogan called Middle Youth, which is sort of a bit like midlife, but a bit younger.
Ahead of its curve.
It was. And then from there, I moved to In Style. And from InStyle, I moved to Marie Claire, where you started in magazines. And I was editor-in-chief there for 10 years. So we've very much had kind of these parallel lives, haven't we?
Yeah.
But I think where would you say we really got to know each other? How do you think
I think
that?
We probably crossed over at Red when I was editing B, which doesn't exist anymore. It's kind of a rival to Company magazine. It's a very kind of that 18 to 25 age group. Mm. But I think probably what works is that we've worked over all this time, all our careers, and I'm 51 now. You're, how old are you, 52 now?
I'm 53 next month, in fact, yeah.
Yes, I'm 52 in July. We have a huge wealth of knowledge of female audiences, particularly that Gen X audience that's come through with us. Because when you edit a magazine, you do a ton of research into what people are looking at. You do hundreds of focus groups and you kind of grow with them through the age groups, don't you? Which I think put us in that place where we sort of know what women are thinking. And I think that's why Postcards from Midlife has really resonated, because we've got this knowledge. We know what women are thinking and how to deliver it to them and what bits of the conversation that's happening in the media that they're just not happy with or pleased with, that we can talk about and change. And we started thinking about this, didn't we? Because I've got four children. They're 8, 13, 16, 17, nearly 18. You've got twins who are
16. Yep.
But we're also very different personalities as well. And we had, I guess, the highlight, the lovely highlight of our career as well, the times that we came most together were the biannual fashion shows. So I went to everything over the 4 weeks, so New York, London, Milan and Paris, and you did too. And we would often be sat next to each other. And we're kind of quite unfashion-y people in a way, or we don't live the stereotype. We aren't the stereotype.
Yeah, we aren't the Devil Wears Prada. I think we did sort of make a beeline for each other, because although we love fashion and we worked on magazines that had a lot of fashion, it was more the kind of women's issues and the broader kind of journalism that was probably more of our forte. And that's where the idea for Postcards really came up, wasn't it? Because we were these sort of emotional wrecks, would you is that how you might describe how we were feeling at that time? I was about 14, I was probably about 50 at that point. You were probably 48 49, and we were just sharing this kind of experience that we seemed to be having, of kind of feeling anxious all the time, feeling these hugely strong emotions that we didn't know where they were coming from. It could be anger and rage, we could be crying, we could be feeling, you know, we used to be, well, we are these very capable, in control, smart, dynamic women who've juggled careers, kids, all of it. And suddenly we were feeling like we couldn't cope with anything. I mean, that certainly was how I was feeling.
Yeah, I think we just... in our lifestyles, and you know, lots of women have very different lifestyles, and we're actually very aware of that. But I had come to the point where I was completely overwhelmed, and I think you were, and lots of other women I met was of the same age were saying, they were overwhelmed, lots of the mums in the playground, and there didn't seem to be any narrative on it that we could tap into. There didn't seem to be anyone talking about why we felt so. I mean, I felt physically awful, and had been offered antidepressants by the doctor, which I really, you know, they're great, they work for people, and I'm all for medicating a problem that really needs medicating, but I just knew there was something physiologically wrong, not something mentally wrong. And actually,
did you think it was menopause? I mean, that's the thing. I think a lot of women like us are going through all these things, but we don't have the first clue that it's related to the menopause, do we? Because we think, oh, that's just something that happens in your 50s and you get a few hot flushes and, you know, off you go kind of thing. But now, having done the podcast and having spoken to all the experts that we have spoken to, we know that it's a very, very different thing, isn't it?
There's estrogen receptors in every part of your body, and any woman, no matter what her background is going to go through this. This is 50% of the population, 51% of the population are going to lose their estrogen after the age of 40 generally. So that's kind of what we wanted to address, wasn't it? It was kind of such a light bulb moment. I thought, of course, I'm a journalist. I have discovered there is a solution to this problem, but it isn't really reported. And I think we also wanted to look at it from a kind of upbeat, uplifting point of view. The narrative around women getting older is quite negative, and that's been happening for many years, and we have the power in the media to change that narrative. So we were thinking, we can absolutely do that. We can do that in our publications, but we can also do that very specifically to the audience that most wants it, and that would be in a podcast, because we can talk about our own experiences. And we have interviewed leading cancer surgeons, we've interviewed HRT experts, we've interviewed people who are advising the government. So we've kind of brought, along with our personal story, we've brought all this information to the fore. And also I hope that we make it feel a bit more of a stylish kind of phase two, happy, uplifting part, celebratory part of a woman's life. I mean, we can't all look like J-Lo at 50, but we don't.
But I know that you really want to.
I want to.
She's your special one, isn't she?
My body hero, J-Lo. Yeah. But it's the earrings I like. It's the earrings. But we can be a lot healthier and happier, and it's quite easily done. So we just need to get that. That was the message we were kind of getting out.
Because I think when you're in it as well, we now know that there are something like 34 symptoms that women can have that can range from, hot flushes. That's the classic one everybody talks about. But actually, not that many women go through that. It can be everything from tinnitus to lack of sleep to
bones aching
to menopause. Pause-induced acne. There can be all sorts of the aching. There's so many different symptoms, and one of them as well is that kind of brain fog of just forgetting stuff all the time. And you just think, oh, I'm getting older, I'm forgetting stuff. But actually, no, it is very much linked to the lack of that estrogen in your body. And Lorraine, you mentioned about having a breast cancer specialist on there. And one of the reasons we did that was because for somebody like me, my mother, unfortunately, she died of breast cancer in her early 60s. And so I had just thought, right, no, HRT, that's not for me. I can't have it. I can't go there. Breast cancer, HRT. And actually, there are so much misinformation around there, which is why we got on a leading breast cancer specialist to kind of talk through that. And actually, since that episode, what I talked it through with a doctor, and I am now actually on HRT, and I honestly am feeling so much better. I'm about eight weeks into it, and the brain fog has gone. I'm kind of coping with lockdown in a very calm, measured, unanxious way, and actually I should be very anxious about certain things, but I'm not. And I really do put that down to the fact that I started on HRT, probably about towards the middle of February, something like that. So, but obviously everything that we do advise that women go and see a professional, talk it through with a GP, because any advice you really must, it's very bespoke, it needs to be right for you.
We discovered an awful lot of proper science during this, but we also found that the emotional side of it for women was incredibly important. It hadn't really been talked about. And I think one of the most interesting episodes we did was the one around female pain and how the history of it and the scientific history of it and the fact that most of the medical profession involved in treating women going through pain are male or it's all the research is done on men and the kind of dismissiveness of female pain made me really think about the kind of whole thing around women and perimenopause and menopause and the consistent medical dismissing of women going through.
Well, it's this idea that we just have to put up with it, don't we? We put up yes. with pain from when we start having yeah. our cycle, and, you know, as teenagers right through childbirth, and but we don't have to put up with yeah. it. That's and also, what science is for.
Yeah. You don't have to be privileged or in a kind of unique, you know, we're from quite normal backgrounds. Mm. We both left school early. We come from, I mean, I come from an incredibly rural place in the middle of Cornwall. And we're from, we've got quite privileged lives, quite nice lives now. And we're able to really find out. But all women go through this. And there should be an availability of treatment for all women on this. Mm. Just the knowledge should be. I went to 3 GPs before I finally got the HRT requirement. And then I went to a specialist, which I paid for. And everything that I learned there was, I'd wasted basically 2 years of kind of struggling through. And I feel a bit bad for my family because it was a, you know, I was working and had 4 children and they probably got the, the brunt of my kind of anxiety around everything, which was caused by the lack of estrogen and testosterone in my body. So it's a shame that women can be going through this. I feel really sorry for women for whom English perhaps isn't their first language, and they've got to explain all this to GPs. So just us getting the message out there, I think, is probably quite helpful. We had Louise Minchin on the podcast as well, and she'd got the message out there on the BBC Breakfast show as well. So the conversation is changing, and I think it's really important that we do
We had a letter, didn't we, from one listener who said that she thinks it actually saved her marriage because she actually got her husband to listen to some of the episodes because she just didn't have the language or the way to try and explain to him what was actually going on and what was happening for her. And she then went to see her GP, got the help that she needed. And she's really like, I really think it saved my marriage because it made my husband understand, made my family understand. And it is the fact that we don't talk about it with our kids. Actually, we should talk about it with our kids. We should explain to them what's going
especially
on with
our daughters.
Sure, so they just understand, you know, why we're feeling like we're feeling. So with the making of the podcast, I think the fact that we're both magazine editors made us kind of come at it in a very sort of structured, I suppose.
Well, you were very structured, Trish.
I was slightly less structured than you. But you know, it's all, we all play our parts. But yeah, the good ideas. You've always got good ideas. And so the way we really thought about how we structured the podcast, didn't we? And we wanted to kind of you know, share a bit about our own lives, but then have a midlife topic that which we've obviously just talked a lot about and kind of lots of fabulous experts on in that section. And that was everything from sex and intimacy through to your
husband hasn't forgiven me for that episode.
I'm not surprised.
I chose to reveal all that live on.
It's a good listen.
It's a good listen.
And then the other segment, one of the other parts of it, is about teenagers and parenting teens, because as you've mentioned, we've both got teens. We love them, but it ain't the easiest of experiences because they're different, aren't they, to how they were as small children. So we tackled a lot of the issues that we were facing with our teenagers, or talked about it and, you know, shared some laughs and also got some advice. And I think the fact that, Lorraine, you do a parenting column in the Sunday Times magazine, don't you? So you have access to all these incredible experts through that.
Yeah, so I do a weekly column in the, it's called a family column. And we do aim it because most Sunday Times readers have got teenagers or older children. And I, over the last sort of 3.5 years, I've managed to speak to a lot of experts and as their books have come out. And it is this perfect storm of having children and being in your probably late 40s, having teenagers and being in your late 40s is quite a conundrum, and there isn't actually a lot written about it. It's a bit like the menopause and the perimenopause. We don't really talk about it in the same way, and I found parenting teenagers quite a shock. I found it much harder than the newborn time, much harder than the toddlers tantruming, because they're adults, they're mini adults, and you've got to kind of not bring yourself into the room with them. It's much more emotional, and you know, you still see them as little ones, and then they go off, you know, and they're leading their lives, and it's also the time they're forming themselves and their bid for freedom. And I just think it's worth always worth talking about that and kind of helping people. You know, I got a lot of response to the column because women had said, I just didn't know this was going to happen. I didn't know I was going to feel a little bit ashamed sometimes of the things my teenagers have done. And I can't talk to anyone about that like I used to with my NCTJ group. So I've got all of that to deal with. And I think it's just a way of dropping some thoughtful help in for people going through those teenage years, because they're hard. And then, I mean, I had my last baby at 43, so my first at 33 and my last at 43, and I'm really noticing the difference in how I parent, because I know so much. I'm hoping that the last one, she might work out okay.
She's going to be perfect.
She's actually quite tricky, yeah. But I think it's, you know, that was the thing we got across. This was another area that there wasn't much information on, and there was a bit of myth-busting to be done. And I think we do that quite well in the show, because we bring on experts, and also we bring our own personal, without betraying our teenagers' confidence, we bring our own personal interests into it, don't we?
This is a sort of phase in their lives and your lives where they're taking more control and more independence, and you're getting less of it. And it is a bit of a shock to the system, but you do have to kind of tread your way through it, don't you, really, for the sake of their development, but also your own personal sanity, I would say.
Well, it also makes us look back on our teenage, doesn't it, Trish?
Oh, yes. And that, yeah, so that's the kind of the third part of the show, really, isn't it? Is where we have a section at the end where we talk about three things. One thing that's changed our life this week, something exciting that we've discovered, whether it's a book or a product or whatever.
And we're trying to be helpful, aren't we?
Trying to be helpful, yeah. And then a little bit of nostalgia noodling, as we call it. And that always throws up a few fun things. I loved your story about jumping on the train up to London at, what were you, 15 or 16?
15.
Without your parents knowing, to go on top of the Pops. We were like going on about how brilliant
Top of the Pops, obviously. to be in the audience with my perm, pink perm, and my I think I had a rah-rah skirt.
Very likely.
Well, yeah, fashion has always figured somewhere in my choices in life.
Yeah, so
but I liked your bit about the Smiths. I didn't take you for a massive Smiths fan.
Oh, yes. Yes, exactly. No,
what are they called? Smiths fans?
I was a Smiths Ranger. Yeah, exactly. So I used to, while you were doing that, I was about 17, I think, when they came to town. And I was really lucky growing up in London and being exactly the right age where you could go out and just, you know, not have to tell your parents where you're going. And yeah, I used to go and see them all the time, which was just really brilliant.
Which probably explains your slightly melancholy.
Oh, do you think?
Yeah. As we've discussed, I was a huge Kid Creole fan coming maybe from the opposite, which probably sums us up generally.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe that's kind of where it's going, really, isn't it?
That's why it works.
We haven't really talked much about this, but how's it going with your gang at home? I mean, we've both got children that should be sitting exams kind of any day now, who aren't. You've got an A-level and GCSE, and I've got my twins should have been doing the GCSEs. How's it going for you and for them?
Well, I feel, and I'm sure you do too, very sorry for them, actually, because it's a grim time upon which we can put no positive spin for them. We just can't make it better, and we can't solve it, and we shouldn't be solving it. We should just be sitting alongside them. I can see my teenager in the garden just lying there.
Someday they've given
up. No, I think she's just given up on everything. But they've lost their freedom. They can't go out. They can't get away from us. They've got no kind of, their future is incredibly uncertain and wobbly. Even if they do get to university and they go back, how's it going to be? Particularly if they're doing practical things where they've got to be close to people. So I feel it's been a kind of 4 weeks. It's, what's it now, 4 or 5 weeks?
Going into six.
Yeah, trying to cheer them up and have some little rituals and daily. I mean, we turned the kitchen into a ping pong. That we found the ping pong bats at the bottom of the drawer. So we just cleared the kitchen out and played it on the table for half an hour. That seemed to cheer them up a little bit. They need a bit of fresh air. It's really hard, I think, parenting teenagers through this. Also, my eldest can't see her boyfriend, and they've been together a year, and it's really depressing because they can't be together and they're going to go to different universities, so they've lost all this time.
Yeah. So this time they thought they would have in the summer, like going to festivals and all of that stuff.
But also, I don't know about you, Trish, but my parents are in there about to turn 80 as well, and for them, the thought of this being the last few years, the living this way, and the last few years, their life is also really upsetting for them, because they know they're not going to be able to be, they're in, still in Cornwall, but they won't be out and about in the way they could have done. They won't be doing all the, you know, their garden centres, all the things. They won't, you know, it feels like we've been robbed both ways, really. I mean, obviously, people are in a much worse situation.
Well, yeah. We've had a lot of hair dyeing going on. We've had pink hair.
We've had that.
Blue hair. Yeah. We've had a lot of stuff going on. But you're right. I think it's like trying to lure them out of their bedrooms and get them out into the sunshine for their vitamin D. And and as you say, you're a great proponent of, as well, of the kind of family meal time and always kind of eating together. And we've really been doing that. And it really does bring you all together, doesn't it? Kind of towards the end of the day. And now I'm in a slightly different position to you, because I'm freelance now. So I don't have the pressures that you have. You're actually working
producing a magazine.
Producing a magazine. How is that going? I can't begin to imagine how difficult it must be, as well as homeschooling for you.
Well, the homeschooling is my 8-year-old is the most troublesome, actually. My 13-year-old is kind of, he's got it, although we did find out he's got his camera turned off the other day, and he's not supposed to. His teacher said, could he turn it back on again so they can see him? But that homeschooling in between while sharing with my husband has been the main issue, because we have very strict deadlines that we have got to get the magazine pages. You know, we've got up to between 50 and 60 pages to get out of the door over a 5-day period on certain deadlines, and everything takes about 4 times as long to put a magazine together at the moment. And also, we can't shoot anything, so we are spending quite a lot of time working with our contributors on what they can do for us without breaking any of the rules, and also supporting all the luxury advertisers and trying to get all that beautiful fashion and beauty in and all the big stories in. You know, we've had some lovely work, written work, from our fabulous contributors and some of the big authors, but it's been quite, you know, you have to keep people close, but you have to keep people moving at the same time. I don't know about you, but these Zoom meetings take a long time, and they are exhausting.
They are, especially if you're living your life on your social life on Zoom as well, which you need to do, don't you, to keep in touch with friends and family. So it's a lot of Zooming, Google
Hangouts. I'm sick of the sight of all of that. Frankly, on this laptop, every morning.
You look lovely. You look great.
Well, do you know what? I decided that we don't walk about in our pajamas in this house. We get dressed, and I think we put our lipstick on and we just get on with it.
Yeah, good for you. I mean, it's going to be a challenging time, isn't it, for so many businesses, and you know, the media, because print, you know, social media, digital, the whole thing is sort of in a huge state of flux and change anyway. And I know I saw a really nice post that you did about trying to encourage people to buy print. What's happening with that?
Well, if you want to sustain, you know, if you want high quality visuals and brilliant journalism, you kind of have to pay for it, and you should be buying a paper, really, if you want the business model to, you know. And I get a lot of, I'm doing a couple of talks for schools actually over the next few weeks, and journalism colleges, about just the importance of print. It's a very different experience from the digital experience, particularly where it comes to fashion shoots and celebrity shoots, and just that kind of beautiful reportage moments in history that we are photographers are keeping for us. It's really important to keep that going, and that kind of visual recording of life is important, and especially what's happening around the world. And we can't give it away for print. You know, paper costs money, and printing presses cost money. We've got to keep it going.
But back in the digital world, we are going to be starting on series 2 of Postcards from Midlife.
We're excited about this, aren't we, Trish? We're very excited about series 2 of Postcards.
So we've been kind of looking at what we did in series 1, and what do you think are the things, what do you think with things we can got right? So if we wanted to share kind of how to do a podcast for somebody who might be watching this and thinking, I want to launch a podcast, what do we do well?
Well, we got to, we were in the top 10 on the iTunes chart. We were in the top 10 on the family iTunes chart. We've been mentioned on This Morning. We've had loads of great reviews. We've got really high.
We're on Chris Evans, Virgin Radio.
So we did quite well. So it was, technically the template was a good launch. The real key was planning it. So I listened to a lot of podcasts before we started, and there's a lot of rambling, as I call it, waffle. But we really planned this in advance, and we really talked to people. We interviewed them before we interviewed them. We got all the facts. We checked everything. We made sure we knew what we were doing. So I think planning, if you're going to launch a podcast, plan it and make sure that you are, you've planned, you've told the story. Your storytelling works over a series of, and then target your media. We also did quite a bit of social media around it. We had the weight of the Sunday Times behind us, which was pretty helpful, and style, it's a good female audience for us, but we were very good at talking to our audience and communicating with them and responding to them and involving them. Also, we did, we meant to be funny, but I think we were unintentionally funny quite a lot of the time.
Mainly with our own embarrassing experiences.
Yes. Yeah. And also the interaction between us is quite funny. Yeah. You're sort of quite bossy and I'm sort of quite disorganized, but I think that worked quite well.
Yeah, sort of organized disorganization.
So Trish, one of the things that I think we need to do a bit more of for season two, see, I said it, it's like a like a Netflix.
It's fantastic. Yeah,
season two. Is we need a bit more interaction, I think, with our lovely listeners, because they've been very vocal. So how are we going to get them to talk to us?
Oh, well, definitely through our Instagram account, which is at Postcards from Midlife. They can also actually contact us individually. I'm at Trish of the Day. You are at Sunday Times Lorraine, and on Twitter. And we're going to be setting up a Postcards from Midlife Facebook group. So we're really kind of, this idea of community is really important to us. And I think, as you say, the first series was very much about building it, but now we know we've had over 200,000 downloads. So we know there's a very big desire and need to kind of talk about this subject, which is fantastic. And there's a book in the office for 2021 as well.
That's quite exciting, isn't it?
It is. I'm very excited about the book. Yeah, so I'm looking forward to seeing you in the flesh again, Rain, sometime very soon. But if not, we'll be able to record. I love the fact that everybody's doing TV programs and all sorts of things remotely, so we can definitely carry on with the podcast in series two. So until then, stay safe.
Until then, everybody stay
well.
Thank you for watching and listening to us.
Thank you for watching.
Bye.